what a lot of Indian cities are witnessing right now is a huge boom since economic liberalization took off. And that the benefits of that boom have been distributed very unequally. So we see that there's a large and growing middle class that wants to live in a world-class city, which it would like to imagine as a possible Singapore or London or Paris. And there are lots of people who get excluded when the middle classes try to achieve this vision. And the route that they've adopted to try and realize this idea of the world-class city, a city that does not have any space for the working class, is to use the instrument of public interest litigation. So what was earlier a legal device that tried to make the law accessible to poor people has now been pretty much hijacked by the middle classes, who are now using it to get very, very drastic actions taken. Measures that end up closing down small factories where poor people work, or measures that end up demolishing slums, which in the absence of any legal and affordable housing in the city, end up being the only places where poor people can find shelter. I think there are two sorts of things going on. One, you know, on the side of social groups and social movements, I think there is an increasing tendency to sort of leapfrog over the process of political mobilization. So a lot of groups who cannot put in the hard work of, you know, grassroots mobilization, or the work of trying to work within political systems by trying to find, you know, legislators or other politicians or community leaders who will, you know, put forward their cause, find it either because these groups don't have the resources or because this is not the kind of politics that they believe in, they end up appealing directly to the court, thereby short-circuiting the entire process of collective mobilization, consensus building, and so on. The courts, on their part, have been really willing to respond very quickly to these kinds of appeals because increasingly we find that judges also come from a certain kind of background. There is no system of judicial accountability. And both the judges as well as middle class litigators actually agree on the fact that the rest of the government, in terms of the executive as well as the legislature, has essentially collapsed. So rather than adopt the harder work of making, say, municipalities respond to the challenges on the ground, or the hard work of making sure that your MLA or your corporator or your, you know, ward sabha member or whatever is doing their job of representing representing you, middle class people find that it's just easier to approach the courts, and the courts are equally willing to short circuit the rest of the apparatus of government and then hand down these orders. And what's absolutely scary is that the orders are really arbitrary, and yet they are sweeping. Whenever poor people in the city have appealed to the courts to, you know, gain some form of recognition in terms of a just rehabilitation policy, the court has actually superseded what the Delhi government was willing to give them, and has said that, you know, giving land to a squatter is like rewarding a pickpocket. You know, completely ignoring the fact that people don't squat in the city because they like to; they squat because they have no other opportunity to find legal and affordable housing. So it's a really worrying phenomenon. And the kinds of concerns that I think are really important in rural areas, ideas about cultural identity, rights, social movements, are all extremely important in the urban context as well. And I think there are important lessons that the urban context throws up for rural social struggles. I mean, for instance, one of the strongest ways in which people in rural areas have made claims to the places that they live in is in terms of cultural attachment. So Adivasis in the Narmada Valley will say, you know, we've been here for generations. We have a cultural attachment to this land. We have legends and histories in relation to this space. And those have been quite powerful arguments in terms of convincing and persuading other people that, you know, these people have a prior right that must come in, that must be taken into account and respected before you think about displacing them for building a large dam or something. In the urban context, we find that in fact those kinds of arguments are actually debilitating. You know, politically they work against people because the poorest people and the most vulnerable people in large cities are the migrants. So whether you look at Bombay and the fact that migrants have been chucked out of the city because of this whole Marathi Manus construct, or whether you think of Delhi, where you find people making pejorative remarks, stereotyping Biharis or Bangladeshis, and you find moves to deport them, are in some ways part of a set of cultural assumptions about cities in some ways belonging to people who were there before. And this notion that, you know, these migrants are coming in and flooding the city, they should go back to where they belong, comes out of, in some ways, the kind of political claims that have been used successfully in the rural context. So this comparison between urban and rural struggles and the kind of cultural claims that people make has in fact made me rethink the grounds on which people should make claims to rural resources as well. You know, what is the cultural resonance of certain kinds of other identities like indigenous identities, and how does that cultural resonance sometimes end up trapping people, incarcerating them into certain spaces? So an Adivasi is all right as long as he or she is in the forest, but if that Adivasi comes to your city and squats near your house and becomes, you know, an economic or an ecological refugee and a migrant, then that person is no longer okay. I think what's interesting about this is that it has certain quite innovative elements. For one, I think the ways in which they're trying to operationalize the idea of social inclusion is really quite interesting in terms of doing it through language, because language today is one of the most distinct ways in which people get separated in terms of social capital, cultural capital, etc. I also like the way in which there's this strong emphasis on hands-on practice, as well as on the development of certain kinds of personal qualities which tend to be either ignored or taken for granted in most professional courses. So the emphasis on professionalism tends to crowd out the idea that, you know, first you need to produce good human beings who care about equality or social justice, or who care about the environment, etc. So I like the fact that this program is trying to, in some way or the other, bring attention back to those core values, which I think must underlie education at all levels. The other thing that it's trying to do, which I think is more of a challenge than perhaps the rest, is the idea of trying to bring together people who work in different disciplines and get them to collaborate, and get students to also just respect the multiplicity of disciplines, but also think of ways of integrating those. And most education in India is so severely compartmentalized. You know, you learn one thing in a very, very narrow way. And if you are interested in the wider world, you pretty much have to teach yourself. So the fact that this gives a combination of both a broad and general understanding of issues, perspectives and so on, and also gives you a solid grounding in one or two disciplines is, I think, a very attractive idea for me.